What is up, guys? Hope everybody's doing well. Darwin Crawford here back. We're going to do another training video today on the field guide to landlording. Whew, nice roast today. Anyway, in case you missed some of the other videos, I am a real estate investor. I live and work here in Scottsdale, Arizona. I have done wholesaling, been involved in a couple of hundred property transactions here locally. I'm also a landlord. I have some commercial property. I had some residential, but I sold that off and moved into some multi-unit commercial. Wanted to make this video today because I've had a lot of different experiences in the landlording business. Some are good, some are bad, some are ugly, some really stress me out. Some are the reason I probably don't have a lot of hair left on my head. A little self-conscious about that, by the way, so let's, you know, try not to make any more fun of you than you have to. But today, I just wanted to go over the system that I've developed, what I call the field guide to landlording. Sorry if you guys hear a little bit of background noise. I am trying out a new microphone, and I also just adopted a puppy 2 days ago. She's amazing, but if you hear her, that's probably her chewing on her toy in the background. I learned that from Tim Ferriss, to go ahead and let you know. Anyhow, field guide to landlording. Let's get started. Where did I put my marker? Somewhere around here. So what I've done is I wanted to go ahead and break this down. This is about rental property. Okay, maybe you have some office property, maybe you have a house that you rent out, maybe you have a condo that, you know, like my last guy on Beers and Stories, he bought a condo when he was single, he got married, then he and his wife elected to keep it and rent it out. So this is a way that you can basically set up a system to have rental property and not go nuts, or even worse, go broke, okay? So let's break it down. Here's the one big question I get from a lot of people are the number of rentals, okay? There's some guys I meet in the business, they're like, I want doors, I want a ton of rentals, I want a ton of properties, I'm okay taking on debt and leverage and everything, but I want to accumulate. They're in that buy mode, okay? Guy that I work with actually is talking about it right now. His goal at the moment is to cash flow $250 a door per month with property management. That's his buy box, okay? So he's established himself a set of rules that, all right, if a property will make me $250 a month after it pays everything else, then I'm cool with buying it, okay? So those are his rules. They work for him. They might not work for you. The point is that this question, there's a ton of math behind it. If you get on Google and search, there's tons of articles on DiggerPockets. I've contributed a couple of them. You can check that out. I'll throw a link down here at the bottom. But it's really about personal preference, okay? I elected to just sell off some property and pay off the one commercial property that I have, and it is amazing. It's such a low-stress way to have money coming in every month. I don't have to worry about the bank. There's a very small check that goes out for property taxes. I just pay that monthly to the state of Arizona, which is fine. I don't want them on my case. Pay your property taxes. But not having that mortgage is just amazing. I've been sleeping better at night. I've got better energy. I got all that kind of stuff. So that's really a personal choice. If you're okay carrying debt loads, if that doesn't bother you, if it doesn't stress you out, then go for it. It's a great way to build a portfolio. But I've taken a slightly more conservative approach, and it's worked well for me. Anyway, let's go ahead and get started. Sales, right? I got a lot of these type of questions. In fact, another guest of mine that's going to be on the Beers and Stories show is having trouble with what I call sales. What this means is having people who want to rent your stuff, okay? There is nothing worse than having vacant property. Actually, I take that back. Bad tenants are worse than vacant property. You heard it here, take it to the bank, okay? So sales. How do you get a good rental? How do you sell it? How do you make people want to do that, right? Everyone's got their own angle. My personal system, and I'll put up some clips and some other videos that you can go check out, is I came from the construction business, okay? So I've been building stuff, welding stuff, wiring stuff, plumbing, whatever, doing woodworking since I was a little kid. I enjoy it very much. I think it's important that everyone do something with their hands just for, you know, mental health, if you will. But my approach to sales is that I have nice properties in nice locations and I keep them nice, right? What that means is floors are new, paint's new, they're nicely landscaped, they got cool stuff. I actually bring some personal touches to it. I just got done with another project. It's on the channel if you want to check it out, but did all these really cool mid-century modern steel panels hung on the wall, these wood walnut sculptures in the courtyard. It's beautiful. Got a lot of compliments, and all the tenants love it and they want to stay. So if you're wondering, what's the biggest thing that's going to trip me up as a landlord? To me, it's not being able to rent your property or having to rent your property to a subpar tenant. And man, it sucks. It just sucks. So, sales. Have a nice place. Take some pride in your properties. Take some pride in your rentals. And let's do this, right? When they're nice, trust me, people are beating down your door with applications. I had a waiting list at this building. Literally, people are going, if anyone screws up and you kick them out, give me a call, right? So that's sales in terms of rental property. You shouldn't, as a landlord, ever have to push your rental on someone just to get a body in the door paying rent. That's, if you have to do that, something is wrong. Your system is broken, okay? Maintenance. Dear God, I could go on about this for days and days and days, but I'm gonna try to keep it short, okay? Property maintenance is a very, very capital intensive game. What that means, if you're just getting into business, that property maintenance costs money and shit breaks, okay? Write that down. Shit breaks and shit costs money. It's just gonna happen, all right? So maintenance, this one is up to you. The way I prefer to do maintenance is I get on top of stuff ahead of time, okay? I'm lucky enough to have been around buildings and construction and all this cool stuff for a long time. I own a bunch of tools, pickup truck, but I have that from years of being in what I call the trades, right? Being in construction. I had a carpentry business for a little bit. I sold lumber and a couple of other things. But maintenance to me is understanding building systems, meaning how things work, how the hot water comes in, how the cold water comes in, how air conditioners and heaters work, how roofs work, how all that stuff's put together. And then developing a plan to go ahead and knock it out ahead of time, okay? Because one thing that really, really kills landlords, and it's gotten to me before when I had, I was up to 11 doors of my own and three other managed properties, so that's 14 doors. Not a big portfolio, but it was a handful, is I hated maintenance calls. Hated them, they drove me nuts. So what I did is I decided that I would plan ahead and try to get rid of 90% of the maintenance calls by doing things preemptively, okay? So let me give you a great example. Here in Arizona, especially this time of year, it's midsummer 2018, it is hot. It is triple digits outside. Everyone's hiding inside, got that AC cranked way down, praying to God that power bill's not too awful. But if an air conditioner breaks, it's a really, really big problem, okay? So the example I use is, back when I had all the residential units, I had my AC guy come out on a set schedule. So I called his office, talked to his office manager, said, listen, I want you out here in October, and I want you out here in April, every year. Not even gonna think about it, okay? So I know that every April and every October, they're gonna come out, they're gonna do whatever magical air conditioner maintenance stuff that maintenance guys do, checking for problems. These visits would usually cost me a couple of $100. There'd be a part here or some Freon or, you know, clean this out or check the coil or whatever else, but it was predictable, right? And the predictability part was awesome because I knew I was gonna have to write the check. I could plan for it. I could put away that $30, $40, $50 a month out of the cash flow. And then when they came rolling out, cool man, thanks for checking it out. Here's your money. I'll see you in October. So all summer when it's hot outside like this, I never had a maintenance call. It's a beautiful thing. I suggest taking a system like that and doing that with everything, right? Sewer lines clogged, get them jetted, right? A plumber will come out to your place and it looks a lot like a pressure washer, but they're gonna take this thing, they're gonna feed it down the sewer, they're gonna wash everything that you put down a toilet or that your tenant puts down a toilet or a kitchen sink or a bathroom sink. Think about that for a minute. There's some nasty stuff there. Everything you put down there gets washed out and it cleans the inside of the pipe. What that does is prevent clogs. Right? Sewer backups and water leaks are very, very destructive. They cost a lot of money. You gotta get your insurance company involved. They're awful. So put it on a schedule, right? I have my commercial building. I've got several tenants in there who are in the hair business. They're hairdressers. So they cut hair, they shampoo. They're putting a lot of hair down the pipes. And I know that that causes clogs, okay? It's how it goes. So what I have is I went ahead and got my plumber on a maintenance contract where he comes out once a year and he jets all the lines. So he's gonna put that machine down there, we're gonna wash everything clean off into the city sewer pipes, clean the inside of the pipe out. You know what? I have never had a sewer clog up at that building. And again, same thing. I know it's gonna cost me $500. I put away that money every month. When he comes out, hey man, here's your money. Boom, done. You see a pattern here? So that is maintenance in a nutshell. People who get in trouble are people who use the cheap, imported crap from somewhere like, no offense, Lowe's or Home Depot. Those guys sell garbage product, okay? They don't sell good stuff, okay? If you're gonna be a professional, all I can say is please act like a professional, okay? Do this right, buy good, preferably American-made stuff. I'm on a personal kick right now here at my house with the Better Half and everybody elsewhere, trying to only purchase American goods or American-made goods if I can. It's not always possible, but I'm trying as hard as I can. I think if everybody did that, it would be awesome. I definitely do that on maintenance. So local suppliers, quality stuff. If it's being sold in Home Depot, it's probably not rental grade. I don't do that with flooring. I don't do that with countertops because the cheap stuff just tears up and it ultimately ends up costing you a lot more money, okay? Property management, okay? This is the day-to-day, collect the money, figure it out, blah, blah, blah. Automate this as much as you possibly can, okay? I use a service for payments called Cozy, cozy.co. I'll put a link up in the description or one down here. So I use Cozy, it's auto debits, so right? So it automatically drafts their checking account, comes right into mine, takes a couple of days. It's free for me, it's free for them. I never have to worry about chasing checks down in the mail, okay? I travel a lot of places in the world. Smartphones are everywhere, technology is everywhere. If you think it's a good idea to wait on a rent check as a landlord by the mailbox, you're an idiot. Let me just go ahead and say it. You are an idiot. Don't do that, right? Automate this stuff or just don't do it. It's so cool to be able to, literally, I had this experience over the last holiday weekend, the first roll around. I was literally sitting on a porch, looking at the Pacific Ocean, having a nice cold adult beverage, phone dings a couple of times. Oh, look, the rent's paid. Great. Back to doing whatever I'm doing, okay? None of this mailbox crap. Just that stuff, it worked great for my granddad, I'm sure, but not for us, okay? Location. This is one of my favorites, right? Super, super critical in the real estate business, but I personally am a big fan of investing locally, okay? All the properties that I've owned, with the exception of one, were within about a 10-minute drive of my house. I live in the neighborhood. I work in the neighborhood. I know people here, so I've got great contacts for suppliers, for handyman, for all this other stuff. The other part is you have to value, the part of this business is about your time. What's it worth? And to me, I don't want to drive all over town, right? Personal preference, I used to drive a lot for a former business that I've had. I don't like to do it anymore. My goal is to have rental properties by my house that require a minimum of maintenance, okay? Because the last thing I want is when there is an emergency, not if, but when, because it's gonna happen, I don't want to have to drive an hour to go figure it out, or worse. Some guys own property out of state, they gotta get on an airplane, and that's just not something that I'm comfortable with, okay? So, location, obviously this is a big one, this is critical. I don't think I'm breaking any laws by saying this, but a lot of times neighborhoods tend to have a certain flavor, you know? Where I live, there's a lot of young professionals, and they need a nice place to live, and they're people that I like to rent to, because they're relatively low drama, they have good jobs, good credit, good income, all the things that I look for in a tenant. I don't really care how old they are, but I do like to work with people that are similar in value to me, right? We like to take care of our stuff. We both have a smartphone. We understand electronic banking, all that kind of thing, because it just cuts down on a lot of the BS. That's who I prefer to rent to. Obviously, I'm not a discriminatory person. You gotta be really careful saying this stuff. There's strict federal laws about it, but the location is gonna determine who wants to live there, right? And the other part is, if you're in an area where, you know, people can afford a nicer place and you make it nicer, they wanna live there, you know? Well, someone who works hard, like, they deserve a nice place to live. They're taking care of one of your biggest assets and you're trusting them with one of their biggest assets. So let's make it a nice one that you guys can both appreciate. It's just, it's a good system to do and it's worked very well for me, okay? The money part. Oh God, the landlording money part. So I get a ton of these questions at work. You know, Darwin, how do you get your first blah, blah, blah? I lucked out, well not lucked out, but I cut a deal with some family where I built a house for someone and then they bankrolled me in the business. That's how I got started, okay? I personally think that you should try to put as much down on a rental property as you can. I am not a gambler. I don't like high leverage. This is not a gambling game, but you are gonna need money. Okay? There's a lot of things that have to get paid for and fixed up and all this kind of stuff before you're going to get profitable in landlord business, okay? So it's a tool. That's all it is. If you have more tools, it's easier to get a job done, right? Ask anybody who's got a job in construction. So money is a tool. I definitely suggest using it. You know, personally, once you move up in the game, commercial property, I learned this, you're going to be putting 25% down. 25%, right? That's a six-figure check you're gonna have to write. The way a lot of people get started is just with one small residence, right? So maybe you can get a FHA loan or you can get just a regular, you know, vanilla ice cream mortgage. Those work great. Try to put a little bit extra down because when you do have those bumps in the road, you know, the AC breaks, you gotta do call plumber, you gotta do whatever, you need a little bit of cushion there. So I definitely advocate putting some money down on these rental properties. Okay? Tenants. First of all, if any of you are watching this, I love each and every one of you. You're wonderful people. You keep me entertained, and I appreciate you taking care of my place. That being said, tenants can make drama. It certainly can happen. I've got another video on the field guide to tenant drama. It's going to happen. I cannot stress this enough. Screen, screen, and screen again, okay? I have people that come and apply to my places, and I'm fairly diligent about calling past landlords and running credit and just kind of checking people out. It blows my mind how many landlords, you know who you are if you're watching this, will throw anybody with a pulse in that property and then complain and complain and complain once something goes wrong. It's ridiculous how much that works, okay? Screen your tenants. If you're in doubt, screen them again. You heard it here. Do it. Though, on the other hand, good tenants, take care of them. They're the ones that are paying your mortgage. They're the ones that are building you equity. They're taking care of your place, and you need to respect that. This is not a zero-sum game, okay? So, nice places, remember we're back to the sales thing, so we're going to have a nice place, we're really going to rent it to nice people with nice credit scores, we're going to get nice rent checks, excuse me, rent electronic payments out of the deal, okay? But tenants, think about who you would want to move into your place, build it, and they will come. It's truly that simple. And I've heard people, I know people who would violently disagree with that statement, I'm not spending that money on my rental, I see these same people. Hopefully you'll see some of them on Beers and Stories because I'd love to get out there so we can, you know, kind of work this out, if you will. All of them complain about vacancy. No one wants to rent my place and I don't know why. I got a mortgage coming up and the dishwasher broke and the water heater. Oh my God, I don't know what I'm going to do. And then hey, you got a picture of it? Let me take a look. Maybe I can find somebody for you. And I look at it and it is a beige, roach-infested shithole. Yeah, I wouldn't want to live there. I wouldn't want my family living there. I wouldn't want the last guy who screwed me over in a business deal living there. It's a dump. Take care of your places. People will show up, okay? That way, you as the landlord are able to screen through tenants rather than the other way around. You're not scrambling to find somebody to fill that space because that's a very dangerous place to be in. Banks. Oh, man. I love you, too. Again, if you're watching this, listen. Bankers have a job to do, okay? They loan out money on properties. It's a frustrating experience for me as a borrower. I've done a couple of bank loans. They were difficult. They were paperwork intensive. On the other hand, I understand that these guys have a business to run, and if a loan goes bad, they have a big, big problem on their hands, okay? So I took a chapter dealing with the bankers from a post I saw on Bigger Pockets. This was a guy, I'll try to find a link to it and throw it in the description, I can't promise, but this guy is someone that I admire a lot. I've never met the guy, but I've watched a lot of his projects. He posts a lot online, and I have a lot of admiration for his business, and I'm trying to emulate it because he's way up in the Pacific Northwest, long way from me, but he takes old, nasty buildings, and he works hard, and he uses the skills that he has to make them nice, and people love to live there. So what he did with the banks is he actually made a pitch deck. So I took this project on, and I can dig it up somewhere, but what it is you make a booklet about what you're trying to do for the banks. You do their job for them, okay? And I know that sounds stupid because the loan officer behind the desk is the one going to make all the points and the fees and all this kind of stuff. But if you come in there and you act prepared and you act like a professional, you've got your finances in order, you've got your tax returns, you've got a recent copy of your credit report, you've got documentation on the last couple of buildings, they really will work with you, okay? They truly will. I would advise going to a small local bank. You know, these are guys, they live, the guy who wrote my loan, actually, he and his wife live in the same community. They're here in Scottsdale. And they like to see local stuff. I mean, they're human, right? They want to see good projects done. We all get excited. I mean, hell, I get excited just talking about it. But the bankers have their own system, okay? It's always going to take longer than you think. It's never going to get done on time. They're busy. You're busy. This piece of paper, that piece of paper. So what I can suggest is to adjust your expectations, okay? Can they get the deal done? Absolutely. Can they screw it up and blow a deal because they took too long? They can do that too. I lost $1 million property about 6 months ago because the bank took too long to underwrite the loan. It sucks, but there's nothing else I can do about it. So anyway, As some of you watching this might understand, this is kind of a recap of an article or a, how do you want to say it, a field guide that I wrote anyway, which is on BiggerPockets. You can check it out there if you want the written version, if it's easier. But this right here, and I'll get more in depth, if you've got specific questions about what to do, etc., throw up in the comments, I'll do my best to get to them. But this is kind of the overall view, right? The field guide to landlording. What do you do when this happens? What do you do when that happens? Are you cut out for the business? And I think the thing that I would end with is landlording is a game where you are kind of playing Papa Bear over a group of people and taking care of where they live, okay? So you have to decide whether or not you're cut out for that business. If you're not a good landlord, you will not make very much money, okay? I love the landlording business, I'm passionate about it, and I truly enjoy jumping in the rentmobile, getting the tools, you know, throwing on what I call my redneck costume. Let's get out there and work with our hands. I truly enjoy that stuff. And I think that's one of the reasons that I have been semi-successful at it, is because I don't mind doing it. But at the same time, there are a lot of people who I've met who have rental property that they're stuck with or whatever else that has a sour taste in their mouth, and they hate it. So anyway, I'll wrap up because I know this one's going a little bit long. This is it, right? This is my system for landlording. It works really well. If you've got nitty-gritty questions, throw them up there. In the meantime, go get some work done. And we've got another episode of Beers and Stories coming up. It should launch next week. It's really cool. It's one of my good friends. Her name's Jordana. Can't wait for you guys to see it. And we'll talk to you next time. Be good.